somewhat like a university. We can call it a school, call it a college, or call it a university. But the media portrays as though, you know, if you go to a madrasa, you'll become a terrorist. Media portrays, not you. I am asking, number one person who has killed maximum human beings in the world is Hitler. Which madrasa did he go to? Which madrasa? Which madrasa he went to? See, today, you know, mafia, the top people in the world from Italy and all these smugglers, if you take a survey that all the smugglers, all the top people that go to the jail, if you take a survey, how many people go to madrasa? How many? A small, maybe a couple of percent. Majority go to universities. Which university? Modern university. Schools, colleges. So can I say that you should close the school? Can I say close the college of education, close BA, close BCom, close BSc? No. Because I know, I have studied in the school. That school doesn't say that you should rob or you should smuggle. You should go against your country. It is they study in that school, but they are the black sheep of that school. So Hitler also may have gone to the modern education. I'm sure that the school he went to didn't teach him that he should kill 6 million Jews. So what we realize that these are black sheep. So as a whole, you know, every year in this country, there are thousands of people who are passing from madrasas, from Nadwa, from Deoband, thousands of them. Do you say that they're going and killing people? They're not at all. It is the media which portrays. And now the government wants to go. And last year or year before last, they went to Nadwa, imagine. They went to Nadwa and they wanted a search warrant they took out to check. To check what? And Alimiya Nadvi, Rahimullah, he said, okay, come forward, check. What they found? Nothing. See, once in a blue moon, one in a lakh, one in a 100,000, one in a million, maybe a person after he passed the madrasa may have been misled. That doesn't mean madrasa teaches that. But a bigger percentage of the students studying from schools, modern education, from colleges, from university, which we get degrees of BA, BCom, engineering, doctor, more of the people doing wrong activity than evil activities. So as far as transparency, brother, I'm for it. No madrasa will ever say that you do not come and check. Our syllabus is open. In our school, we are teaching, mashallah, we are teaching comparative studies. My student from my school knows more about Hinduism than average Hindu. He knows more about Christianity than average Christian. He knows more about Islam than an average Muslim. Because we pay attention to both of them. So as far as transparency, brother, is concerned, I'm for you, I'm with you, and no one will ever say that you don't come and analyze. Come, but don't blame. Don't come with a negative mind. Come with open mind. You may never know, you may get hidayah. You may come to the truth. Yes, brother.
Create an atmosphere of encouragement for non-Muslims to come and learn something and see for themselves. That is what I mean by transparency, so that people should not have suspicion that something wrong is going on, something good is going on. But you should make it transparent.
Brother asked a very good question. We should make it transparent for non-Muslim to come and study. Brother, first invitation I give to you and your children, come to IRF. I give invitation to you. See, Islamic Research Foundation has a library. It is one of the most well-equipped libraries, at least in India, of scriptures of different religions. You know, we have more than 200 different types of Bible, more than 50 versions of the Bible. We have more than 50 translations only of Bhagavad Gita. We have several translations of the Vedas, of Rig Veda, Yajurveda, Atharva Veda. You may not find in the library of your government. You may not find in the library of maybe your school of thought. We encourage, study and come to the truth and leave aside others. I give the first invitation to you and to your children. I will even bear the air ticket free. Come to IRF and we welcome you. Study and we will learn the truth together, inshallah. Can you on the microphone? Yes, brother.
I wish to thank you that you have taken my suggestion in the right spirit, and I will take opportunity to avail of your offer.
Please, just write to us, I'll send you an ticket, inshallah.
Let us have a question from the sister's side, please. A non-Muslim sister should come forward and ask a question, please.
Adab, Dr. Zaknaya Saab. My name is Venkatamma. My एक मुस्लिम लेडीज आदिया मैडम के पास रहती हूँ कई सालों से। मेरा सवाल है, आप बोलते हैं कोई भी मजहब गलत चीज नहीं बताता, गलत काम करने के लिए उत्सुक नहीं करता, और आप क्या वजह है जिसकी वजह से इस्लाम कबूल करने के लिए बोलते हैं तमाम मुस्लिम?
Sister asked the question that she lives with a Muslim for several years. When I said that all the religions speak good things, then why do the Muslims ask me to accept Islam? Point number one, I say that all the religions, most of the things they say are good. But Islam, besides speaking good things, shows you a way how to achieve that goodness. And I give the example, all religions say don't rob. Islam says the same, but Islam shows you a way how to achieve a state in which people will not rob. Give zakat, give charity. After that, someone robs, chop off the hand, there will be no robbery, there will be no crime. So in this way, I try to explain that Islam, besides talking about good things, shows you a way how to achieve that state of goodness. Secondly, if I have to say, being a student of comparative religion, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, assuming you're a Hindu, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, if you have to be a good Hindu, your Hindu scriptures say, there is one God. I quoted all these verses in my previous answer. One God. Your scripture says don't do idol worship. Bhagavad Gita chapter number 7 verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. They do idol worship. You have to believe in one God. I said in my lecture today that you have to believe in the Antim Rishi, the Kalki Avatar, whose father's name will be Vishnu Yash Abdullah. Mother's name shall be Sumati Amina, who will be born in the village of Sambala, Makkah. Who will be born with the chief of the village of Sambala, chief of Makkah. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will get enlightenment at night in a cave. He will go northwards and come back. He will be given 8 qualities. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will ride a horse. He will have a sword in the right hand. He will have 4 companions. He will be helped by the angels and devatas. On and on and on. Who is this person? If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in the Antim Rishi. Otherwise, you are not a good Hindu. If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in one God. You don't have to do idol worship. Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. There is no idol. There is no image. There is no photograph. There is no sculpture. And I have had dialogues with pandits of Hinduism. Vishankaracharya. Many. And I have quoted this. No Shankaracharya told me, Brother Zakir, you are wrong. No one. I had a dialogue with Sri Sri Ravi Shankar on 21st of January, supposed to be the most popular spiritual guru, Art of Living. I told him, the best book on Art of Living is the glorious Quran. I asked him to join our club of Art of Living. We have 1.3 billion members. 1.3 billion members. I gave him an invitation. If he follows the scriptures, he's supposed to be a scholar of the Vedas, he should come to this. Similarly, sister, when I say that all the other scriptures, even if you agree with the word of God, by the passage of time, they have been changed. Swami Vivekananda says that 99% of the Vedas have been lost. Whatever 1% we have to follow it strictly. Strictly means believe in Antim Rishi also. So if you follow it strictly, you will have to believe in Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, have to believe in the Quran, and I give you an invitation, sister, to come to this religion of peace so that you can come closer to Almighty God.
Question from this mic here, please.
I'm Anthony. I'm a student of philosophy. So what I learned from what you spoke is that all religions speak, you know, many things that are common, and even Muhammad is common in all religions. So what is so unique about the Quran? What is unique that Quran offers to other religions? In fact, even Muhammad is, you know, not unique to the Quran itself.
Brother asked a very good question. He said that let's follow what is common. So all religions speak about Prophet Muhammad. So Quran speaks about Prophet Muhammad. So what is unique? Very good question. All the other religions say that there will be a prophet to come later on, as the Bible says, you being a Christian and a student of the Bible, I believe, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to tell you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, all that he hear shall he say. He shall show you things to come. He shall glorify me. That means all the scripture, Hindu scripture, Parsi scripture, Buddhist scripture, Jewish scripture, Christian scriptures, talking about a prophet to come, a prophet to come, a prophet to come. But Quran says, this is the prophet on whom the Quran is revealed. The prophet has come. When you study standard 1 in the school, the ultimate is standard 10. When you go to standard 2,